people will never touch. I suppose you could call this the conspiracy to end all conspiracies, Robbie.
Yeah, it's fairly far out there.
It is very far out there, and if you're wondering what I'm talking about, folks, it's do we live on a flat Earth or is it a globe? And it has there been a conspiracy for the last number of years to cover up the fact, or not fact,
the probability
that we live on a flat Earth? Now, I'm not saying it's true, folks. As far as I'm concerned, we live in a globe. That's what I've been led to believe growing up. That's what we were all taught in school, that the Earth is round and we spin around the universe and blah, 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 blah. And now, since February, there's been a lot of videos been popping up online called Flat Earth Clues, and I just stumbled across them, and I've had a good look at them, Robbie, and I can't fault the guy's logic.
Well, for such a thing like that to come up, you know, you do have to dig deep and ask questions. Mm. You know, curiosity kills the cat. And fair play, you have this guy on tonight, and he's obviously done a lot of research, because I've seen a lot of his work on the internet. Very plausible, but I'm still sitting on the fence.
I'll do a quick bio of Mark before I bring him in, folks. Mark Sargent, he's based over in the United States. He's not a conspiracy theorist. Now, I spoke to him earlier on. He's a level-headed guy, very well-spoken. He's not a fired-out-there, tinfoil hat-wearing conspiracy theorist. He's just looked at this subject, and he's pointed out some anomalies, some clues, some hints, tips. And I've looked at his videos, and I find it very hard to fault his logic, to be honest with you. And that's one thing I do there, was when I get a guest on, I try to debunk what they're saying. If I can find that and that goes against what they're saying, well, I'll bring it to their attention and, you know, try and get a discussion about it going. But this, I couldn't really find any fault, I suppose, with the guy's logic. So with that, I'm going to bring Mark Sargent in now. Good evening, Mark.
Hey, Mick, how's it going?
Not too bad. Listen, you're very welcome along to my show, The World You Don't Know.
I'm sorry, what?
The World You Don't Know. You're very welcome to the show.
Oh, yeah, well, thank you. Thank you very much for having me, man. It's a pleasure.
You're more than welcome. Now, I was just saying to my listeners there that you're not some conspiracy whack job, tinfoil hat-wearing lunatic sitting in a basement. You're just a normal guy who, according to yourself, used to be a professional gamer,
i.e.
playing games at big conventions and stuff like that and getting paid for the pleasure of doing so. So you're just a normal everyday guy who stumbled across this subject.
Yeah.
Can you give us a little bit of background on how you fell into this?
Yeah, more or less. I mean, of course, like a lot of people that are online, you know, you run into conspiracies here and there, and I'd looked at, you know, just about all of them over the years, you know, entertained some, not entertained others. And this one kept coming across my desk, and I thought it was ridiculous. It's like, it's silly. It's silly. And I'm just not going to, look at it. And then one time, you know, sometime last year in 2014, I decided, okay, you know what? I'm just going to take a look at this thing, and I'm going to disprove it. I'm going to debunk it because it was just silly. It's like, I might as well just address it. So I started staring at it, and it turned into a Pandora's box where every time I thought I had it, more questions kept popping up. And then 9 months later in February, I just woke up in the middle of the night, had that Jerry Maguire moment where I said, you know what, there's something to this, and I'm gonna make some short videos on it, and started up Flat Earth Clues. I thought it was kind of catchy, and you know, but I initially I wanted to prove the globe, and I couldn't do it. So once I started putting the Flat Earth Clues out there, it started gaining traction for whatever reason. And before I had done like clue 6 or clue 7, people started calling me and saying, look, we need to talk about this. And now I firmly believe this topic, which was absolutely ridiculed, you know, I would have laughed you out of the room last year, has come into the mainstream of the conspiracy world to where now is literally a legitimate subject.
Mm.
So
that's like I said, I've had a good look at most of your videos. And I find it hard to fault your logic as well. Okay. I'm not saying it is true, but there's been experiments done. There was a famous experiment done, if you want to talk about that, along a canal in the UK.
Ah, yes.
Do you want to talk a little bit about that one?
Yeah, it's not my favorite one because, when we talk about the curvature of the Earth or anything math related or physics related, you tend to lose some people. But what they did was they said that with the curvature of the Earth, you should be able, if you had a flat, calm body of water, like that canal, you could send a boat from one end to the other, and if you had a telescope, you know, on the one end where it started, eventually you should lose visual range because of the curvature of the Earth. And it didn't. That boat should have not been seen. And there's some wonderful YouTube videos out there where people are doing the same thing, where you know, they have high-def cameras, and they show a ship which you cannot see in the distance, but if you zoom in, you know, because the camera technology has gotten so much better, you can see this boat now. And yeah, again, the curvature theorist, not my favorite one, but there's some argument out there. And the reason I say that is because I don't truly use the tabletop flat model, which is traditional with the flat Earth societies and the international flat Earth research groups. I use more of the one that was done by Orlando Ferguson back in the 1830s. He was another guy from the United States, called the flat and stationary Earth, which is shaped more like a roulette table with a few curves in it. But that's neither here nor there.
Now, can I ask you? What's the official line from governments in the education system, right? We live on a globe.
We live on a globe, and it's been that way since the 1500s. Anybody that knows their history, Copernicus, he was the one that kind of started it, although he didn't publish it till after he died. What before that, for the first 4,500 years of our civilization, every government, every culture, every tribe, every backwater place believed in a flattish type circular world with a dome. It's an enclosed structure, the firmament out of Genesis.
Now,
And
I read that the other night. I was in my friend Robbie's, and I mentioned that to him. We actually read that passage in
That's right,
Genesis.
Yeah.
Do you want to explain to the listeners what you think the interpretation of that passage should be?
I believe, it's Old Testament, so time frames are tough to follow. But I believe that, and again, there's a whole bunch. There's a wonderful guy that's done more research on it as far as a biblical standpoint. His name's Rob Skiba, Skiba, who interviewed me and did his own stuff. And he follows just about every passage in the Bible. And I won't be able to quote him chapter and verse, of course, but what my interpretation is that when this place was built, it was built like we knew it from old, and that was a flattish circular disk that was covered. And the Genesis verse is, a firmament that separates the waters above from the waters below.
Now, what do you think waters above are? Do you think that's outer space?
Could be outer space, could be physical water, for all we know, or it could just be an area outside, the world, a dimension above versus the dimension below. We don't know, because to date, no one has ever, gone past this thing and come back to tell the tale.
Right, so, like, as far as, the world is concerned, we do live on a globe, okay? This is what mainstream will tell you, like,
Of course.
We live on a globe.
Yeah.
It's how many miles in circumference? 22,000 miles or something like that?
If it's 1,100 miles an hour, yeah, it's actually around pushing 25,000. I'm not going to look it up in front of me because I know.
And it's spinning at a particular speed. Something like,
spinning at about 1,000 miles an hour, pushing 1,100 miles an hour at the equator. Yes.
So, that would mean that if you were on the equator compared to somebody who was standing on the North Pole,
yes,
the G force alone, because you can get this way if you're on a roundabout in a children's playground, you can feel it.
Yeah.
If you're on the outer edge compared to being in the middle of it,
yes,
you can feel the G force. So
yes,
that would mean gravity would be a lot different on the equator than it is in the North Pole, and yet it's not.
Yeah. And that's a good argument, because it's what I don't bring it up in the clues, but it's a good one. And most people should be able to get their head around this. And that is, like a merry-go-round, if you're standing on the edge of the merry-go-round, it's trying to throw you off.
Yeah,
now,
I had that yesterday. I had my little 2-year-old in the little merry-go-round. It was a little cup that you could spin, and I could feel the centrifugal force.
Perfect. But if you're standing in the middle of that merry-go-round, there's nothing. You're just going in a circle. So the argument is, we probably don't have time to talk about the water, but the argument is, look, if you have a 100-pound weight or a 10-pound weight or whatever, let's say it's a 100-pound weight at the North Pole, and you weigh it, and it weighs 100 pounds, if you take it to the equator, it should weigh a little bit less. Maybe not 10 pounds, maybe not even a pound, but it should be measurable. We've got some awfully precise measuring devices, and no one's ever done this. And I think it's a fantastic test so heck, maybe I'll do it one of these days.
Wait, I have got a question here. I'm just going to go into just bear with me for a second.
Sure.
It's actually a question that a listener sent in, Ray,
mm-hmm.
and it's in relation to Concorde.
Yeah.
And the fact that the Concorde was cancelled, even though only one plane went on fire. I mean, they don't cancel all Boeing 747s and how many of them bloody crash.
Yeah.
But one Concorde accident, and after 30 or 40 years, it's cancelled.
Yeah.
He thinks it was probably cancelled. And he also mentioned as well that the Concorde never actually flew in the Southern Hemisphere. And the Southern Hemisphere is something that plays big into your theory of a flat Earth.
Yeah. So
do you have any views on why the Concorde might have been put
Maybe, I watched the Concorde footage, during the crash thing and the engine caught fire. I don't know if it was related. It's possible, I suppose, but that's the first time anyone's brought up the Concorde to me, to be quite honest.
Right.
Sorry.
It wasn't something I thought of anyway, but in relation to the flat earth. It's just my friend Ray said it to me last night on...
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's an interesting thought. I mean, as far as the conspiracy about why the Concorde was canceled, boy, you got me. I mean, it's a fast plane, and actually, that's an interesting point that you had mentioned. I'll have to do some research why it wasn't used in the Southern Hemisphere, because that would have been the perfect plane for the Southern Hemisphere, especially between South America and Australia.
Yeah, that's something I wanted to bring up as well. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. Clue 7, that was one of the things. In fact, that's what really got me into this early on, which was I found a video on YouTube. It was made by this German guy who had talked. He said, look, there's something wrong with the plane routes in the Southern Hemisphere. He goes, the routes don't make sense. There's connections all over the place. You can't get a direct flight anywhere. And the routes are bouncing you are taking way longer than they should. And he couldn't figure out why. And I go, well, that's kind of odd. And somebody had tied it to, I don't know if it was him or somebody else had tied it to you know, like a flat earth theory. So when I started looking at it, that's exactly what it looked like. I could not get frickin' nonstops from anywhere in South America to anywhere near Australia, you know, be it Sydney or New Zealand or, you know, around there. And the ones I could get didn't, I couldn't, so I eventually said, look, you can't get any nonstops. And then people were emailing me saying, no, there's like two or three nonstops. And that, of course, should have bothered them alone. It's like, so 95% of the flights in the Southern Hemisphere are these ridiculous connections, but you're going to tell me there's three or four nonstops, therefore disproves flat Earth? No. So I stared on some real time GPS flight trackers, especially planefinder.net, and I was watching them, and I realized the oceans were completely empty all the time. And I watched for like a week, and I couldn't figure out why. It didn't make any sense. So then I started watching the planes a little more closely, and the planes, as they got like 150 miles, 200 miles offshore, they blinked out. They disappeared off the GPS system entirely. And not only did they disappear off the public tracker, but the plane logs also deleted them. So when you can look up the plane logs, and because that'll tell you, you know, every so many minutes where they are. And those changed from an actual location, you know, longitude and latitude, to approximated or estimated, which basically meant they were flying blind. Nobody knew where these planes were, which is ridiculous. It's a global positioning system. You know where all these planes are at all times. So
do you think it's doing that to hide the fact that...
Oh, yeah, absolutely it was.
A flat plane as opposed to a ball earth.
Yeah. By the time I got to Clue 9, that was... Because I hate to say this, because I like putting myself in other people's shoes, even if it's the government or the authority. And I thought, yeah, that's exactly what I would do. To get out of people's mind, I would hide every freaking flight below the equator as far as from their destination, from point to point A to point B. And that's what was happening. The plane would disappear shortly after takeoff and then reappear like an hour before touchdown. And this would happen not only in the oceans that I would expect it, like the South Pacific and the Indian Ocean, but also in the South Atlantic, which shouldn't make any sense. You know, it shouldn't make any difference. But that's exactly what was happening. I was going, oh, they're doing them all. Because they're going to hide everything. And then somebody came back to me later after Clue 9 and said, you know, what if it's bigger than that? What if it isn't that they're turning off the flights? What if they can't track the flights? Because the satellites in question, the GPS satellites in question, are not there. They're triangulating with towers, they're using planes, but there's these big gaps in the system, and so they just, you know, they ignore it entirely. And it's basically became this out of sight, out of mind thing. It's brilliant.
No, I was listening to a few of your radio shows that you've been doing, Coast to Coast AM. I had to listen to that this morning when I was lying in bed.
Yeah.
I think you mentioned, where am I going with this now?
Satellites?
The satellites, sorry. Yeah, are no satellites, that they're all, there are no satellites up there.
Yeah, initially when I started on this, you know, I believe, because you got to go through this in layers. This is not something you can jump into the deep end and hope you'll stay afloat, because you'll go crazy. There's too many things you have to give up. And one of the first ones was, well, you know, we have satellites, right? And it's like, well, it depends who you're talking about that has satellites, because I've watched, you know, I watched with night vision up here in Colorado, up in the States, night vision binoculars, and the sky was crawling with stuff. And I was going, oh, it's got to be all these satellites. But every time I looked, they were doing weird things. They were changing direction. They were going ballistic. They were flying in formation. And I was going, what the heck am I looking at? So then I started digging into more, you know, other people's research, especially stuff about the ISS. And when I was looking at the, and this is the big one, you know, for those people don't, you want to get your head around it real quick. Here it is. As far as the Americans are concerned, the ISS footage, the interior shots, not the exterior shots, you know, where you can see an IS thing flying overhead, whether that's real or not, I have no idea. But the interior footage is absolutely being faked. Everyone that's bouncing around in there, and you can watch these videos for your for yourself, called ISS hoax. If if we are faking, if the United States is faking the interior footage of the ISS, then what can I trust? Because we should be able to, you know, we have the technology. We should be able to have people up in orbit. The only reason you'd fake it is because you can't do it. Not because you don't have the technology, because you physically are unable. There's something stopping you. So, yeah, at this point, I go on record and say, look, if it's above spy planes, because I buy that, if it's above spy planes, which cap out at like 20 miles, and you can take all sorts of fun pictures at 20 miles, I don't believe it. Not for a second.
I mean, sorry, Robbie, you have a question there.
Yeah, Mark, just on that topic there on satellites in the sky.
Yeah.
Now, go back to Genesis chapter 1, and it says God created a light, which was the day, and then he created a lesser light, which was the moon.
Yeah.
Now, if there is a flat plane we're living on, how would you explain what's revolving around us to, you know, make this night sky and this day sky?
Fantastic question. I'm glad you asked that, because I've had lots of people say, you know, are you anti-religion? Are you going against religion? I go, no, absolutely not. To address the first part of your question, that is, did God create the planets and the stars and the moon and the sun? Absolutely, he did. However, it never said how big the moon was, how big the sun was, how far away it was. That's all man. NASA was the one that said that sun was 92 million miles away and that the moon was 237,000 miles away. In my model, and it's not even an original model that I came up with. I'm using the, you know, old models. The sun and the moon are physical objects, and they were way closer than anyone has any idea. I mean, they are hovering above us like a mobile. I don't know what you guys call them over there, like a mobile above a child's crib. Where the sun is just really a giant ball of light. I'm not going to diminish it and say it's a light bulb, and the moon is a giant nightlight, and they are three-dimensional objects. I have no doubt in my mind, and then because that's what you'd want to do that in a design for something like that. As far as the stars and the planets are concerned, they are a very, very well done rendered image that is in the sky, but it as far as being tangible, as far as being able to reach them, not a chance in the world.
And I think you've kind of backed up that with Crow777 on YouTube.
Yeah.
His Lunar Wave, which is another big hit. I've looked at a lot of that.
Yeah.
They've took shots in different states. At, I think I was looking at one of your videos there the other day, where he knocked off his camera and another guy in a different state actually filmed the Lunar Wave at the same time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and me coming from the gaming world, it took me 2 seconds to figure out what was going on in Crow's video, because I was looking at it, and from a game design standpoint, I'm watching this and my mouth drops open. I'm just going, why is there a refresh issue with the moon? Why is there a resolution? Because that only happens in graphics. That only happens in computers. And I'm watching this. Anyone has any doubts, you know, if you want to know, which is why I mention them, you know, I put them on a very short playlist on my channel, which is, look, if you want to know what's going on with the moon, watch his stuff. Because after you watch it, then you're going, okay, if that's happening, then what the heck did the astronauts do? And the truth is, they did nothing. It was a sham since day one. And at this point, I'm trying to keep people, and I know people are going to come at me because I'm from the United States. But NASA, get as far away from NASA as you can, because
Mark, I need to go to a quick ad break. So, do you mind holding on for 2 minutes and muting your microphone while I'm on?
Sure, you bet.
Right, I'll be back in 2 minutes with Mark Sargent, folks.
Okay.
Liffey Sound is your community station. Visit us on Facebook, Twitter, and on our website www.liffeysoundfm.ie.
If you're considering improving your home with replacement energy rated double glazed windows and doors, why not visit Keen Windows Showrooms beside Liffey Valley Shopping Centre, open 7 days a week. You'll find an extensive range of double glazed windows, over 50 composite doors on display, and a superb range of patio and UPVC doors. Keen Windows has earned an excellent reputation in the window business by looking after our valued customers. We offer a professional service from the moment you ring us to our after-sales service. For a free quote, visit our showrooms or visit keenwindows.ie.
Liffey Sound 96.4 FM's new winter schedule includes some great new shows covering all tastes, including OTK with Chris Clark, Monday 5 to 6pm. Jim Sherlock returns on a Tuesday from 6 to 7 with some great gospel music on the Inspirational Hour. Our Community Hour with various shows and presenters each week is from 9 to 10pm on a Wednesday. Fiona Dalton is back jazzing up our lives, Thursdays 4 to 5pm. If you're a fan of trad music, don't miss the crack with John Saunders on Thursday from 6 to 7. Eco Ear with our new presenter Una Ruddock, Friday 6 to 7pm chats about eco issues that affect us all, and another new presenter Nicole Geernan talks arts and culture midday on Sundays. All can be found on 96.4 FM and liffysoundfm.ie. Your community station.
Listen online now at liffysoundfm.ie.
Did you know you can listen to Liffey Sound FM live directly from our website? Just visit liffysoundfm.ie and click on the picture of our studio on the homepage. You can also check our updated schedule with shows covering all tastes. Also, our contact details can be found here. So if you or anyone you know is interested in volunteering with us, please get in touch. So log on to liffysoundfm.ie and enjoy the music and chat.
If you're considering improving your home with replacement energy rated double glazed windows and doors, why not visit Keane Windows Showrooms beside Liffey Valley Shopping Centre, open 7 days a week. You will find an extensive range of double glazed windows, over 50 composite doors on display, and a superb range of patio and UPVC doors. Keane Windows has earned an excellent reputation in the window business by looking after our valued customers. We offer a professional service from the moment you ring us to our after-sales service. For a free quote, visit our showrooms or visit keenwindows.ie.
Join Mark Hanratty every Thursday night here on Liffey Sound 96.4 FM for his Songwriter Spotlight. Each week, Mark brings you behind the scenes of your favourite bands, your favourite tunes, and the songwriters behind them. Fascinating insight into the music industry's real heroes. That's Mark Hanratty's Songwriter Spotlight, Thursday 8 to 10pm on Liffey Sound 96.4 FM and liffysoundfm.ie.
The Elm Leaf, a stylishly decorated restaurant over three floors in the heart of Lucan, serving fresh, locally sourced food at reasonable prices. Open daily for lunch 12:30 to 3 with dinner each evening. Early bird, Monday to Thursday, 6 to 7:30. Friday and Saturday, 5 to 7pm. And all day Sunday, from 1 to 9pm. From the weekend of May 9th, 10th, brunch will be served each Saturday and Sunday. We have an exciting cocktail menu also. So do come in and give us a try.
A creole erin reason down the ag liffysoundfm.ie. Agus a nícha sé punca car FM. Jogi, Liffey Sound.
Now, folks, you're very welcome back. Hopefully, I have Mark's still with me. You still with me, Mark?
I am still with you.
That's brilliant. Listen, I just want to give out the text number for anyone who wants to text in. Folks, if you want to text the studio with any comments, it's 087-062-7138. That's 087-062-7138. Now, I just want to read out a couple of comments that I've gotten in relation to what we were talking about. Mm-hmm. And this is off Ray over in England. He says, also, it would start making sense of a lot of the Bible. Cain being cast out of the garden, was he being cast here into the earth? And the Tower of Babel builders, did they have the technology, and was it really feasible for them to build a tower up to heaven inside a dome? Given the illusion of never-ending open space, no one would even consider trying that again. And then also considering the learning and access to books, Archbishop Usher would have written, the earth was created the night preceding the 23rd day of October, the year before Christ, 4004. So he says that's around 6pm on October the 22nd, 4000 and 4 years before Christ. James Usher, or Usher, 4th of January 1581 to the 21st of March 1556. He was an Irish Archbishop of Armagh, and he wrote about Flat Earth as well. And he was talking about, you know, the Tower of Babel.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Inside the dome. Do you think there's anything in
that? Oh, yeah. Can I address that? Absolutely. Clue 8, which was called Creative Force, and even though everybody got it, I never mentioned the Tower of Babel by name because I was hoping that people would piece that together on their own. But absolutely, when I was looking at the Tower of Babel story, you know, which is also another, you know, a very old story, Genesis, it didn't make any sense in a globe, because why would you build a tower that goes nowhere on a spinning sphere? Makes no sense. Why? Where are you going? However, in an enclosed system, in a flat Earth where it's enclosed, and if your technology was good enough, because I believe advanced civilizations lived before us, then you absolutely knew where you were going. You were going. You had a destination. You measured it. You figured the whole thing out, and you were charging the gates. And we all know how that story ended. You know, they were building the tower. It looked like it was going to happen. God said, "Oh, geez, these guys can do anything. We gotta stop this thing in its tracks." And the division of the languages, and there you went from there. But yeah, brilliant story. Loved it.
Now, can I ask you, if we do live in an enclosed thing, I mean, this is the Truman Show on steroids, to be honest with you.
It is. Yeah.
The moon landings, now there is a lot of talk about them being a hoax. There's even documentaries on the mainstream TV now about them being hoaxed.
Yeah.
And Jay Widener, I'm sure you've heard his name pop up online. He made some great documentaries in relation to Stanley Kubrick.
Yep.
Kubrick's Odyssey, faking the moon landings on the set of 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Yep.
What's your view on that?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, I think Jay lives fairly close to where I am here. I think he's in Colorado. But there was two documentaries out. One was called Kubrick's Odyssey. The other was called Moon 237. Yeah. And absolutely, Stanley Kubrick, for those of you who don't know, he built in, and I have no doubt in my mind, he built into the movie, the 1980 movie, The Shining.
There's loads of hints about the moon landing's been faked.
Exactly. That he faked it, and he couldn't confess it, of course, because, you know, he knew it would happen. But he built all the clues into the movie The Shining, 1980, and which was based on a Stephen King book, which he just pretty much, you know, changed the script and did what he wanted to. And then nobody got it. You know, he died, I think, in 1999. And nobody picked up on it until a few years later. And it was like, holy smokes, that's exactly what he did. No, from over here, from our standpoint, if you're older than me, and I'm 47 now, if you're older than me, yeah, you probably still believe the moon stuff. But if the younger generation is having a really, really hard time because the internet has just destroyed the moon, dismantled the NASA program, the Apollo landing program over the years, and to the point where NASA has even had to make a secondary wiki channel, which I still love throwing out there. People don't even know it's out there. It's called third-party confirmation of Apollo landings. It's an entire separate wiki section that says deliberately, right in the header, that says not endorsed by NASA or the U.S. government. That's how bad they've been hit over the last 10 years. It's basically, you know, don't take our word for it. Listen to these other countries, and the credibility, it just gets worse and worse every year because the landings themselves just get more and more cartoonish.
But now, one thing you mentioned on your show, and Robbie has a question for you. He's going to come in now in a second.
Yeah.
But one thing you mentioned on your show, you mentioned Hollywood and the fact that although the moon landings, if they did happen, were the biggest event in human history as far as mankind's achievements are concerned.
Yes.
And yet they have never once ever made a movie about the actual moon landings.
Oh, so
there are a million and one films about space exploration, like Armageddon and loads of other movies, and Interstellar, which I'll get to now in a second.
Yeah.
But they never actually made a movie about how they got to the moon and show you the landings and all that.
Yes, and thank
you. So there's a reason for that.
Yeah. Thank you very much for bringing that up, by the way, because lots of people, you know, up until now, I don't think any interview has actually broached that subject and just thrown it out there. And because they said, oh, it's kind of weak. I'm just going, what are you talking about? It was the one clue I put out there, and people glossed over it. And that is, look, the moon landings were supposedly the greatest achievement in human history. And Hollywood, you know, the United States, you know, other countries, of course, make their own movies. But Hollywood, especially since it's the U.S., makes movies about everything. We make movies about, if somebody freaking sneezes and it looks funny, we make a movie about it. And nobody, since those moon missions came out, no one has made a movie about it. No one's even tried to make a movie about it. That's the weird thing. Not even a straight-to-video movie. The closest we ever came was the 1983 Right Stuff, when it was just basically an astronaut training program movie, and then 1995 Apollo 13, which never actually landed on the moon. It was all shot in a capsule. And that was it. Nothing else, and it just blows my mind. And that shows you how big it is, because not only are they trying to control this thing from the real life side of it, they're trying to control it from the fiction side of it. If you had a script and you thought about making the moon movie, you're not going to get to do it. The closest anyone ever came was Capricorn 1 in 1978 or 1979. And that was, you know, How to Fake the Mars Mission. That was an independent film. A major studio didn't even do it.
Now, did you ever see Stanley Kubrick's last movie, Eyes Wide Shut?
Of course, yes.
Now, I don't know if you're aware of it, but the big orgy scenes in that movie now were filmed in Wallasdon Manor in England.
I did not know that.
The ancestral home of the Rothschilds. That's the main
mansion. Really?
Okay.
Really? And they let him film that?
It is, yeah, and they let him film in their mansion. Now, this is just, Buckingham Palace hasn't got a patch on this place.
Wow.
And you can Google it, like Wollaston Manor, it's the Rothschild mansion in the UK.
Oh, fantastic.
And Stanley Kubrick filmed the main scenes of his last movie in that place. And it's a pure Illuminati, Masonic sacrificial type film, you know?
Oh, absolutely.
They shot the whole movie in that house.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it was like a final favor to Stanley for...
Oh, I'm sure it was. The man, in my opinion, was the finest director of all time, and because he was so smart. He built so many clues. And yeah, he didn't even have to build clues into that one. That one was just a slap in the face.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I know that was his last movie. Yeah, his last movie. And that's,
like, he didn't complete it himself.
Yeah, yeah. And there's rumor, and of course I'd love to get my hands on it, you know, that the original cut, the cut that he had, was never released.
Probably not. I mean, he was probably whacked. The amount of star whacking that's going on in Hollywood at the moment is sort of off the scale. You know, you just have to Google, what's that guy's name of Independence Day? Dennis Quaid, Randy Quaid.
The pilot, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Randy Quaid, yeah.
He's gone off the head, that poor man is. He's getting
pissed.
People in Hollywood, he has some videos out there saying they're trying to kill him and whatnot. You know?
Yeah, Randy, poor Randy. I don't know what's going on with him. Hopefully he gets better soon, though.
I feel sorry for him. Yeah. Well, there's nothing wrong with the man.
No. I mean, I hope whatever happens, you know, I hope it gets resolved soon, whatever's going on.
It's like the powers that be are out to get him, because I reckon he was about to talk, to be honest with you.
Maybe.
Mark, another question there for you.
Yeah.
Time zones. If we live on this plane and, you know, as you know now with this round earth, mm-hmm. we have the 24 segment time zones.
Yep.
How would you see this operating on a plane?
How does that... Yeah, and I get that question a lot, actually. Because and what your question is basically asking is, how can you have time zones if it's flat? Because the sun should be shining on everything all at the same time. Basically, right. The sun should never set. In my model, again, I'm going to refer to the Orlando Ferguson flat and stationary Earth map, where it's slightly curved at the at, you know, towards the, in the northern hemisphere where we are. That handles the sunrise and the sunset way more elegantly than a tabletop flat model. If you went with a tabletop flat model, you'd have to do some tricky things from a design standpoint, meaning you'd have to make the sun sort of a directional light source, even though it appears to us to be an omnidirectional light source. So you could do it either way, but the easier way to do it is to have a slight curve. Not a complete, you know, globe curve, but some curves here.
The degrees on it, say.
Yeah, yeah.
So another clue that I watched on yours was the horizon.
Yeah.
The fact that if you're in an airplane or a balloon or wherever it is and you're going up in a straight line all the way up, the horizon rises with you and stays at eye level all the time.
Yeah.
You maintain that on a curvature, a ball earth, that shouldn't be the case.
That wasn't my video, but that's okay. I'll bring it up because that one comes up.
It was in a video I seen online.
Yeah. No, it's okay. There's a lot of videos that are coming out about this stuff. The stuff that's been coming out lately is really showing weather balloons. And what happens is, and again, if there is a slight curve, it is really, really slight because I still can't see it. And that is, depending on what weather balloon you see, you'll either see a curve. Yeah, it'll stay straight. So there's some wonderful footage. I think it's called Dog Cam. And that is, they get up to about, you know, because weather balloons, you can shoot them up to about 120, 130,000 feet before they blow. And the Dog Cam at about 110, 115,000 feet, you know, beautiful HD footage. And it was perfectly flat. However, the Red Bull team, you know, which got national attention, NASA endorsed it, you know, everyone was behind it. The Red Bull team, when they were up there, because they use a fisheye lens, showed a severe...
Felix that dived down to Earth, that guy Felix.
Yeah.
I can't think of his surname now. He's got some German surname. But he dived off the...
Yeah. And all his footage from his GoPro, he had a fisheye lens on his freaking GoPro.
But that's going to give you a curved earth.
It's going to give you a curved everything. I mean, yeah. And the dead giveaway was they also had a secondary camera, not a fisheye, in his capsule. And so before he jumped out, he opens the door, and you can see the plane in front of him, and it's perfectly flat. As soon as he jumps out, you know, it's curving all over the place. And that is a big argument. But as far as disinfo goes, it works pretty well, because lots of people say, well, there's the curve, obviously. You know, it's like, no, it's a fisheye lens. The lens, that type of lens has been around for forever, since photography's been around. So.
Oh, so you maintain fisheye lenses, you know, through all of these images, you know, of space, etc., they would be using this fisheye lens.
They're going to use either fisheye for a straight shot. They're going to use a fisheye lens. If they're using the underwater stuff, you know, and it's not a big secret that we train our astronauts in the underwater simulators. If they're using that, they're probably using green screen. on top of that, or they use a combination of green screen and fisheye lens. It's hard to tell what exactly they're doing.
It's funny you should mention green screen, because we know how Hollywood use predictive programming. They stick little hints and tips into the movies and stuff like that. Now, there was an advert running on TV over here for an insurance company called comparethemarket.com.
Yeah.
And they have these little characters, these little meerkats, and the little ads they have is like comparethemeerkat.com. But they're getting more and more famous. Like 5 years ago, you just see the meerkat popping up on screen, but now they're turning into this little adventure, and they send these adventures, but they send them to Hollywood, the studios in Hollywood, the Universal Studios, and they're flying around the studios in a little golf buggy, you know, and they crash into Arnold Schwarzenegger and they spin off, but they go into one of the studios and they go right across the studio where you were doing the moon landings in front of a green screen.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, just letting you know, this is how we did it in the first place.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's funny the way they done it, you know.
There's lots of people to take shots if they can. Again, you know, Diamonds Forever, 1971 with Sean Connery in the James Bond film, where he runs across a moon stage, you know, and the astronauts can't catch him, and I love this part, they can't catch him because they're still in character, so they can only run in slow motion. It's brilliant how they were doing that. And then he gets in the moon buggy and drives off. And that
the reason I say that, like about these little hints in Hollywood. I don't know if you're aware of a truther out there called Jordan Maxwell, are you?
Yeah.
He's an American guy now. He's been at it for a long, long, long time. He's like the father of the conspiracy theories.
Yeah.
And I was listening to him one night, and he was explaining about how the Illuminati work and stuff like that. And he was saying, if they want to do something on you, say like 9/11. Mm-hmm. And it's a big event to them. It's a sacrificial event and stuff like that.
Yeah.
To them, it's a form of magic. And in order for their magic to work, whether you believe it or not is irrelevant. These people do.
Yeah.
And he says, in order for their magic to work, they've got to tell you what they're going to do. But they're not going to directly come up to your face and say, listen, we're going to do this to the Twin Towers.
Yeah.
They'll put it into movies, hints and tips. It's like The Simpsons from 1997 pointing to the Twin Towers. And it'd been $9, so you had your 9/11 there and stuff like that.
Or...
plenty of other hints in
Back to the Future was another
Back
movie
to the Future,
that had tons of hints.
Yeah, wasn't that a weird one? Because that one, I remember seeing that in the theater. That's 30 years old.
Yeah.
And that was a brilliant one. Oh, yeah, by the way, the Simpsons thing you mentioned, the 9/11 thing, but what else did the Simpsons do fairly recently? The entire, for the movie, which was the biggest Simpsons thing of them all.
Dome,
the entire city was under a dome.
And then you had Under the Dome, the program that was running recently on television.
Yeah. It's current. That's based off a Stephen King book, and that's currently running in the States right now, Under the Dome. It's an interesting film about a small town completely under a dome. The Truman Show, of course, Dark City, a movie that just came out recently called The Signal, and I know it's a spoiler for those who didn't see it last year, but where they found out at the end the entire system was underneath a dome in the Southwest. It was and that was hovering in space. All sorts of little tips.
It's like The Secret's about to come out, then, so they sort of use a predictive programming just to let you know.
Yeah,
but what we're living under.
By the way, you mentioned Interstellar. Did you want to address that, or did you?
Well, I did. Yes, it was just that I spoke to you earlier on about that opening scene, Matthew McConaughey.
Yeah.
Where he's given out to a teacher about his daughter being given a different book.
Oh dear.
And the book was about the moon landings, and the teacher says, "Well, the original book that was given out in the 20th century and the early 24th century was fake. That we never went to the moon, so now we're giving him the correct version to tell the truth."
Yeah, and that's an interesting.
It's just threw it into the film for some reason.
Yeah, exactly. You didn't have to write that into the script. Why?
It wouldn't have made a blind bit of difference if it was there or not. It wasn't dependent on the rest of the movie.
No, it had no bearing on anything. If anything, it just stuck in your brain, and lots of people remember that scene because it was
so... you've done that in The Sopranos. I seen an episode of The Sopranos in 1999. Now, I watched it in 99, and then I never copped it in 99, but it was only after 9/11.
Yeah.
But it's the same way one of the characters jumps into an FBI agent's car.
Yeah.
Totally out of blue, nothing to do with the conversation they were supposed to be having. He says, those World Trade Center MFs, or those Egyptian World Trade Center MFs.
Yeah.
Or mother truckers. And... If you remember, 9/11 was 19 Egyptian hijackers.
Yeah.
And that was in The Sopranos 2 years prior to 9/11 taking place.
Wow.
Now, it's like predictive programming. You just put these little bits of information into these.
And by the way, one more thing I want to throw in. I know you got other questions, but and that was the movie Gravity, which came out last year and was nominated for all sorts of stuff. Sandra Bullock. You got to understand that from a technical standpoint, that movie was brilliant in that – You could have cut those scenes. You could have taken out scenes of that movie and shown them to people as truth, intermixed it with other footage, and people would have bought it. That's how good Hollywood has gotten at their game. So don't think for a second that some of this stuff can't be faked. Of course it can be.
Right. Yeah. Listen, Mark, I need to go to my last set of ads, so do you mind hanging on for 2 minutes and muting your mic?
Sure.
Right, folks, I'll be back in 2 minutes for the last segment of the show with Mark Sargent. Talk to you all very shortly.
You're listening to Liffey Sound, 96.4 FM.
Looking for the best price for your home and breathtaking results? Call us at Team Ray Mulligan of Remax Results Lucan, as featured on TV3. Call us now on 01-628-3660, 01-628-3660, or office at teamlorraine.ie.
Have you missed one of your favourite shows on Liffey Sound FM? No problem. Simply log on to liffeysoundfm.ie and click on the podcast section at the top of the page. Here you'll find a great selection of our shows for you to listen back to at a time that suits you. Alternatively, you can visit mixcloud.com/liffeysoundfm to see a full list of podcasts available. Liffey Sound is your community station.
Lucan District Credit Union has been serving the Lucan community for nearly 50 years. Members can save and at the same time borrow against their savings for any number of things, such as home improvements, a car, education costs, and all at a low cost. Joining the credit union is the easiest and best decision you could make. So why not pop into our offices at the Mallor and Finstown Shopping Centre or visit our new website, www.lucancu.ie. Remember, your future is safe in our hands. Lucan District Credit Union is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Tune in to Liffey Sound 96.4 FM on the first, second and fourth Saturday of every month. From 6 to 8pm, our new presenter William Burke, formerly of Anna Livia Radio, presents a new opera series entitled Opera Works. That's the first, second and fourth Saturday of every month, 6 to 8pm on liffeysoundfm.ie and on 96.4 FM.
On 96.4
Community Radio at its best.
Liffey Sound FM.
Now, folks, you're very welcome back. Now, you're still with me, Mark, yeah?
I am.
Lovely. Now, I just want to read that one more comment from Ray before we move on.
Yeah.
Because I want to try and cram as much into the last 15 minutes. Now, this is from Ray over in the UK. Thanks for this comment, Ray. He says, well, I have a slightly different take about the flat earth, about the shape of the flat earth than Mark has. He says, nature loves lenses. Every eye has one, even the third eye. Maybe the earth is more lens shape. This would allow a slight curvature. Oh, and I didn't get the Tower of Babel thing from his vids, but he says, watching what I did of his videos got me thinking, and that popped into my mind, amongst a lot of other things. He says he loves your work. So there's another fan over in the UK who's going to spread your work about the place.
Thanks, man.
He's a regular listener to the show. He's one of the very first listeners to my show.
Yeah.
And a very nice man as well.
Cool.
Now, just moving on now, I want to mention Admiral Boar to you.
Mm-hmm.
He features quite a lot in your videos and your interviews.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He does, and he was my turning point, really. And that was, I had my doubts and I had my reservations, but once I watched Admiral Byrd do what he did, I couldn't turn back. And that was, he was, America's greatest explorer, did the North Pole in 1926.
And he's more famous for the North Pole. He doesn't, I know we did speak about the Antarctic on some TV interviews back in the 50s.
Yeah, yeah.
Mentioning how the mountains are cold and the amount of resources that are down there.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
What I can't get my head around is why did they have this international treaty to bar everybody, all corporations from any exploration work in Antarctica?
Yeah.
And yet they don't mind them raping the shit out of the Northern Hemisphere.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And again, just so yeah, and people are going, where have I heard Admiral Byrd from? He's most known for the hollow earth theory, a great thing. Look that up when you get a chance. But yeah. That was the big thing. It's like after he did his work, he was looking for something down in Antarctica for 30 years, from 1928 basically until 1956, goes on national television over here in the States and says, in 1954, and says, look, yeah, there's tons of resources. The place is made out of money, oil, coal, uranium, minerals, and there's no indigenous plant life. There's no indigenous animal life unless you count the penguins on the coast, and I don't because there's just a few penguins there. And there's no, no old ruins or anything. There's just millions and millions and millions of square miles of resources. Piece of cake. Everyone's going to carve this thing up. And all of a sudden, very shortly after that, they left the ice. All the countries left unilaterally at the same time. Russia, America, England, Argentina, Chile, New Zealand, Australia. They all left at the same time, put a treaty in place in 1959, which basically says no corporation can do any work in Antarctica ever. And the initial 10 nations signed it in 1959, and every country, as they became more economically viable, when they became a world economic power, they had to sign on to this, where I think there's 52 nations that have signed on to this, probably including yours, where you can't, you're basically signing your thing saying, by the way, you can't go down there. And that goes against everything we are. That, you know, as far as mankind goes, everybody knows that oil companies and energy companies can do anything they want. If you want to burn down a rainforest, you can bribe enough people to do it. You want to go fracking, you can do it in places. You can lobby and you can bribe people, and money and greed and power is the rule of the day. And that same rule does not apply down there. And that goes against everything. I'm just, you know, from a capitalism standpoint, it just shocks me, because I look at that and I go, how is this even possible? In fact, not only are they not allowed to go down there, they're not even allowed to petition to go down there. They're not even allowed to talk about it. You don't see them saying, well, you know, Exxon and British Petroleum, you know, are trying to get into Antarctica. You never see stories like that because they can't even do it. They're not even allowed. The treaty isn't even up for negotiation at this point until year 2041. And it's ridiculous.
Do you think it's like that because Admiral Board went down to the Antarctica, figured out that the Earth is not a globe, that it is actually a disc. And talking about that, Ray sent another comment in saying, do you have any opinion on the lens shape?
Yeah. It very well could be a lens shape. But even a lens shape is not a globe.
It would have an outer rim even if it was a lens shape.
I'm sorry, what?
An outer rim, you know, like a rim right around the outside.
Oh, yeah. There's going to be a rim. Yeah, even if it's a lens shape, it's still going to be a flat circular thing with an edge. And when Admiral Byrd, yeah, that's the speculation there. And that's what I firmly, firmly believe, because everything screamed structure. And that is, it's one of those things. Remember, I put myself in their shoes. And that's one of the first things you would do. You would seal off that continent entirely. You could not let a corporation get in there, because once you did, they start moving, you know, inch by inch. It's like, oh, hey, how about this 100 miles? Hey, about this 100 miles? And eventually, you're going to have to stop them and explain why. So eventually, they just said, you know what, we're not even going to deal with it. And that, it's like, wait, what conspiracy is bigger than money? Because there are, it's almost none that I can think of. And then, of course, once, you know, NASA took control of the sky, and then the Van Allen, here's a coincidence for you. The Van Allen radiation belts, which were announced by NASA, by a NASA employee, Van Allen, the same year that they seal off Antarctica.
The Van Allen belt is supposed to be so radioactive that you couldn't pass through without being fried anyway.
Yeah. And that's the elephant in the room. And by the way,
how did the moon lander get through it then?
Absolutely. When NASA and I face each other, and it will happen one day, I almost guarantee it, that question will have to come up. That's the elephant in the room. And that is, how do you make 6 round trips through a Van Allen radiation belt with no shielding to speak of, and nobody dies, there's no radiation sickness, those capsules aren't contaminated, you know, they're in the Smithsonian, you put them in the museum right away, everything's great, and nothing goes wrong. And you announce that, the Van Allen radiation belt, the same year you seal off Antarctica.
They didn't even talk about that radiation belt. They just, we're going into space all the time.
They shot themselves in the foot, because they said it was a great idea in 1959. I'm not gonna give them crap for that. 1959, it was like, oh yeah, we'll create this thing that will keep people from even thinking about going up there as far as private companies. But 10 years later, they hadn't solved the radiation problem. The only way to stop radiation, as far as we know, if you go to the dentist, is lead.
That would make a very heavy space shuttle.
Exactly. Yeah. You can't use lead in spacecraft.
I got enough lead as a child and sold the scrap bags.
You can't fly an anchor.
Yeah. Exactly. And by the way, that leads me to one other thing, and I won't waste too much time on it. And that was, there was a problem that bugged me about the moon missions for the longest time. And that was, people kept arguing, you know, whether the moon missions happened or not. And everyone, you know, on the other side said, well, why would they fake it? Why would they fake it? And that bugged me too, because I couldn't think of a good enough reason. It's like, yeah, there's national pride, put a flag up there or pretend to put a flag up there. But if it's an enclosed system, it changes that. And that is, it's not that they wanted to fake the moon missions. They had to. You absolutely had to fake everything.
Now, I want to ask you another question. This is in relation to what's going on today globally. Yeah. Chemtrails. Do you think chemtrails have anything to do with hiding this supposed
Earth? I get that question probably 5-6 times a week. And
what's your reply to that question?
Well, it's possible, but I don't think it's...
Just really think that poisoning the shit out of everybody.
Yeah. I don't think it's one-dimensional. I mean, if it is obscuring something, it's obviously us, no question. You know, we know our planes are doing it. We know, you know, what companies are making the stuff. We don't know what's in it exactly. You know, are they genetically modifying us? Is it a nanotechnology? Is it a disease? I don't think it has... If it's obscuring flaws in the enclosed structure, yeah, maybe, but I think there's more to it than that.
Do you think it's anything got to do with CERN? with opening these alleged portholes, you know, if there's anything shown in the atmosphere or the sky, you know, is a masking over anything?
It's possible. You know, the CERN thing has been really intriguing for me because, you know, from a man's standpoint, you know, we try to, of course, our first instincts would be to break through this thing, which I believe we try to do for 4 years with the atomic
nuclear testing in the atmosphere.
Yeah, yeah. Just look up high
altitude. All of a sudden, didn't they?
Yeah. They just cranked that up. I mean, like within a year after the rocket program in 1957, they started that in 1958. The Russians and the Americans both just fired up the biggest things they ever had, and they kept doing it for 4 years. And then after that, they stopped and never did it again because, it was obvious to me, well, they couldn't get through it, so they just map it out and figure out what to do there. Then HARP comes along. It's like, okay, maybe you can use a frequency thing maybe to get through it with HARP. Yeah, that didn't work. What else we got? We got CERN. Maybe open up a gateway to where you don't have to try to break through it or phase through it. Maybe you can walk out to another dimension. It's tough to say. Is chemtrails tied to CERN? Maybe. It's so wild though when you get out there.
But there is actually so much going
it's fast,
on.
Well,
I personally believe everything is connected. Rob.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Just one more question, Mark.
Yeah.
On the Antarctica.
Yeah.
Now, if you were not allowed to travel down there, now I watched a good documentary there some time back about after World War II,
yeah.
The convoy of American ships, etc., yeah. Went down there and they were intercepted by some flying discs when they got down to that area.
Yeah.
Now, if that's the case, it seems to me that Antarctica would be running right around the rim, you know, of our, our plane we live on.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah. And you're talking about the 1946 U.S. operation called Operation High Jump, which, of course, was commanded by Admiral Byrd, because he was the youngest admiral in the history of our Navy. And, yeah, supposedly they messed with some discs down there. And people are saying, well, you know, it was the remnants of the Nazi fleet and you know, did they take care of it? I go, whatever happened with Operation High Jump didn't seem to be that big a deal because by 1954, they were, you know, basically soliciting companies to try to carve that place up. So whatever happened then, maybe, you know, I think they took care of it, whatever it was. Sorry.
But do you believe this Antarctica stretches right around?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, I do. I do. And in fact, that's one of the ways to prove this.
If it's a flat earth.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. So it's going to be like a nice barrier all the way.
Yeah, 2 miles high. So you can't.
Well, yeah. It starts out fairly shallow, you know, 150, 200 feet, you know, at the shore. But yeah, then it ramps up really quick, and it's really an unusual continent. And that is, it goes up to like a 2 mile high plateau, and it stays at 2 miles. You know, it's unique compared to all the other continents in the world. It's hostile on all levels.
Now, just one more, because we've only got a couple of minutes left.
I want to ask
a big question. If we do live on an enclosed earth,
yeah.
And there is a dome over our heads,
yeah.
Who's responsible for it? Who put that there?
That's
the big question.
That's the big question. Did the divine put it there? Did God subcontract it out? Is it an advanced civilization that put it out there? I know it's not us. You know, are the ships that are flying around in our atmosphere, and if you don't believe in UFOs, you probably shouldn't be listening to this show. Do the UFOs have something to do with it? Yeah, maybe. You know, could they be the superintendents? Could they be the maintenance team? Could they be the janitors? All possible. But I do think it's absolute proof of intelligent design, and I've said in the videos that if you find the structure, if you can actually get to the structure, it is the handprint of God, and it changes everything overnight once you find it.
Now, Mark, sorry, just on that note, another thing on Admiral Byrd, when he found this hole, you know, into this inner earth, do you think there's any possibility we live on so many planes, then each plane has a different civilization?
Yeah. Yeah, very possible. Not only physically, but maybe dimensionally.
Planes, the seven of them.
Yeah. If it's dimensionally, then absolutely. We could have civilizations living right on top of us. No question. When it comes to the hollow earth theory, you know, remember, 95% of our population lives in a very, very narrow band. I mean, yeah, we cover a wide range of land, but we only live between sea level and 5,000 feet. So to have another civilization underneath us, you could do that really easy with a subterranean system, no question. But yeah, what you're talking about, dimensional frequencies and other civilizations living right on top of us in the same space, absolutely possible.
Right, I've one more question for you, and this is just coming from a listener, a good friend of mine, Colin.
Yeah.
He asked me that, I think it's a very good question as well.
Yeah.
He says, Mick, ask your man, your guest, basically. This is how we say often in this country, ask your guest, why would they lie about this, you know, about the globe earth? How does it benefit them at all, and why push it so much?
It's okay. It's easy, and I know we're running out of time. It's easy. Watch the clues. I covered in clue 5, but the short version is this: men in power don't. Not only do they not like giving up power, they'll hold on to it like grim death, but they also don't like changing it. If this is found out, all the major religions of the world get their holy grail instantly, overnight, and religion gets to come back against science and come back with a vengeance. And they don't want that. Even though they know they could probably recover, you know, in a decade or two, maybe three, they don't want to deal with it. It's too much trouble. So right. they'd rather just keep it as long going as long as they can. And I think they're running out of time. And that time, I believe it's now.
Yeah. I'm unfortunately running out of time. Mark, listen, I'd love to get you on the show again. Will you agree to come back on sometime?
You bet.
Brilliant. Well, we'll get you back on in the very near future because this is a fascinating subject.
Oh, it's been brilliant.
And yeah. I could do a 10-hour show with you, no problem. So I'm going to make arrangements to have you on in the next couple of weeks if you don't mind.
You bet.
Brilliant. And I've also forwarded the details over to my friends at Open Your Mind Ireland. Hopefully they'll get in touch with you and you might get on there sometime throughout the year.
Fantastic.
So until next time, Mark, thanks very much for coming on The World You Don't Know.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Mark,
you.
Been
thank
great
you. Talk to you
take
again
care.
Soon.
Okay.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Now, folks, that was Mark Sargent, Flat Earth Theorist. Fascinating subject, Robbie.
It was. But, you know, there's still a lot there to be answered, you know. But really, really interesting. And